Hello everyone, this is MJ with MinIO. Welcome back to the MinIO and Kubernetes and MinIO Kubernetes Operator course. In this video, we're going to talk about the different Kubernetes options for MinIO, and there are numerous. And we're also going to walk through a basic YAML deployment, so single tenant deployment of MinIO on a Kubernetes cluster. So MinIO can run on any Kubernetes cluster that supports all the common Kubernetes features and is API compatible with upstream Kubernetes. So as I've spoken about before in the lab setup video, if you skip that one, we'll go through these again. Some of the examples of supported Kubernetes distributions include Amazon EKS, Google Kubernetes Engine or GKE, Azure Kubernetes Service or AKS, and then of course Red Hat OpenShift or OCS, as well as Rancher K3S, RKE, and RKE2. This is not to say that these are the only ones that are supported by MinIO, but these are some of the most common ones that you're going to run into. And these are all CNCF certified and essentially have all the proper API capabilities to support MinIO running on those systems. So if you already have these up and running, you can go ahead and work through the lab on that. Or you can refer to our previous lab setup video where we walk you through actually getting a lab environment set up to actually do these labs on your own if you don't already have a Kubernetes cluster. So the first thing we're going to talk about is deploying MinIO and Kubernetes using the manifest files. These are just going to use the Kubernetes YAML files to actually do the deployment, but there's going to be some slight modifications to the files that we use just because those files on the website are meant to be generic and they will require some customization on your part to make MinIO run properly on your cluster. So in this section, we're going to deploy a single node, single drive MinIO server on Kubernetes for early development and evaluation of MinIO object storage and its S3 compatible API layer. Note that this is really not intended for production, but rather, as it states here, for development or evaluation of the product. And then later in the course, we will use the MinIO operator to deploy and manage production-ready MinIO tenants on Kubernetes. So that will be more of the enterprise-focused version of that, but this one is just for development and testing. So the first thing that you're going to want to do is to go download this MinIO dev YAML file from the MinIO GitHub repository. As I said earlier, this is an example file. There's going to be some things that we're going to point out in here that you will likely need to change to make this run in your environment properly. But this file describes two different Kubernetes resources. There is a namespace for the MinIO dev namespace, and there's also a MinIO pod using a driver volume on a worker node for serving the data up. So that's really the only two parts of this. Here's an overview of the default YAML that gets downloaded. So you'll note here that we are creating a kind of namespace and indicated here, this is MinIO dev. You can change this value if you would like, but you'll need to remember to update the namespace used in the next section I'm going to show you if you want to use a different namespace here. Here's the next section of this file, and this actually deploys a pod. It's a MinIO pod, and note here that it indicates that the namespace is MinIO dev. So you'll want to make sure that you update that if you have changed this previous namespace to be something different. The next section actually spells out the container spec that we're going to be using here. So we're going to be pulling the container MinIO latest. We're going to call it MinIO. And these are just some of the commands that it's actually going to run when it comes up and running. And this is where it's going to be different depending on your deployment. So there's going to be some mount paths here, and those mount paths relate to specific volumes that you have mounted. So in this case, this is actually using a local volume, and the provisioner that it expects to find there is local volume. Now, it's likely that if you've used some other system or even gone through our lab environment, that this will not be the name of the storage class that you will be using. So you will need to update this. Another note here is that the node selector specifies a node label associated to a worker node where you want this to run. This kubealpha.local might not be the name of a worker node in your cluster. And so you can either update this to a actual name of one of your worker nodes, or you can completely remove this section and it will just run on any node in your cluster. But please make note of that. If you try to run this out of the box and you have some differing options here, either the volumes, the volume path, the storage provider, or different node name, then this will likely not work for you out of the box. So you will need to make some modifications. So an overview of this, the MinIO resource definition uses Kubernetes node selectors and labels to restrict the pod to a node with matching hostname labels. So that's important, as I said before, because if you do not have a pod with that label that you've indicated in that file, then you will not be able to run this successfully unless you either update that name or completely remove that section. The MinIO pod uses the host path volume for storing data, or local path, and this must correspond to a local driver folder on the Kubernetes worker node. So again, you'll need to update this if you are using a different storage class and different storage provider within Kubernetes. And then experienced users may modify the following to meet more specific requirements: the spec node selector, as I indicated, the volume mount's name, and the volume fields. To apply this out of the box, you would simply do kubectl apply minus f in that minio-dev YAML file. And you should note that there will be two outputs from that, basically indicating that a namespace and a pod were created for MinIO. So that should be what you get. And if you go and actually do a kubectl get pods minus n, because you need to specify a namespace, you should see that there is, in fact, a MinIO pod running. Now, it might not be if you have not updated that file properly, so please pay attention to that. You can also use the following commands to retrieve additional information about the pod status. You can run kubectl describe pod MinIO and then the namespace that you have indicated here, and kubectl logs pod MinIO minus n MinIO dev for the namespace as well. This will give you some more in-depth information about the health of that pod and what's going on from the logs perspective running inside of that specific pod. Before we jump into the demo of this, I wanted to show you the docs real quick. I highly recommend that you visit the docs often if you're doing this sometime after this video has been recorded, because these docs are updated to suit the latest version of MinIO. So I want to make sure you're always running off the latest version and the latest instructions. So you'll see here that if you come to the docs website and go to Kubernetes and upstream, the information that you'll see here is for deploying this YAML. And so if you come down here, you'll see what we just talked about. This is downloading the MinIO dev YAML to your host machine. It also gives you an overview of that YAML here and gives you some indication of fields where you may need to update this file. And actually, in the demo, I'm going to show you how we're going to update it for our lab environments in order to work on there. But if you just follow these instructions, this should get you through to being able to have this up and running on your system. So here we are in our demo environment, and I have two panes up here on the same host because I want to show you the difference between the YAML file that we're actually going to run. This, in this case, it's our K3S cluster, and then the difference in the default MinIO dev YAML file that gets downloaded. So first, let's download that file by running this curl command here. And if we do an ls, we should see that there's a MinIO dev file here. So let's actually take a look at that. So here you can see that this is the default file that was downloaded. This is what we showed in the slides and also on the website. And you note here that there is a namespace, which is called MinIO dev. And then we just have the default options down here for running the pod, as well as the pod spec, which includes the kube alpha name, as well as the local path and host path mount for the volume. In our case, in our lab environment here, we're actually running K3S, and it does not have the same name, so we're actually going to remove this section, as well as we're using DirectPV for our storage. So let's take a look and see how the other file differs. So here's our K3S and DirectPV specific MinIO dev file, and note up here that we're still using the namespace for MinIO dev. Down here, it differs slightly because we have actually removed this section that uses a node selector. So basically, this is going to let it run on any node in our cluster that the cluster determines has enough resources to actually run this pod. So we've actually removed that. We've also updated the mount path names just so they make a little bit more sense. So in this case, we're using DirectPV. So we're calling MinIO DirectPV volume, and that's the name of the volume that we use down here. These should be the same. And then the claim name is MinIO DirectPV PVC. That's in addition to this, because for this to work, we actually need a persistent volume claim to call against DirectPV to actually claim that space. So DirectPV is automatically going to provision the persistent volume from our request, but we do need to make a specific request against DirectPV. So we've added a new field down here, or a new section down here, called persistent volume claim. And the name of it is MinIO DirectPV PVC, which matches this claim name right here. The namespace is MinIO dev, and the access mode is read write once, because the only container that's going to be able to use this is the MinIO pod that we're running. And the storage class name is DirectPV min-io. So that is specific to the storage class that we have running on this particular machine. And we're requesting 50 gigs of space in this case. So this is going to go through and create the namespace, create the MinIO pod, and then create a persistent volume storage claim that actually provides the storage to our MinIO pod to store anything that we upload to it. So please note those differences, and also make note that if you are running on a different system, your options may be different. So we've gone ahead and closed that second pane because we don't need that anymore. And we're just going to go ahead and apply our custom YAML file against our K3S and DirectPV cluster. So we'll do kubectl apply minus f minio dev K3S YAML. And that's going to go ahead and create those three resources. So the namespace, the minio pod itself, and the DirectPV persistent volume claim. Let's make sure that these things all got created as expected. So first we'll do kubectl get ns for namespace. And you'll see here that there's a minio dev namespace. That's what we expected. We also do a kubectl get pods minus n for the namespace we want to look in. And that's the minio dev namespace. And we will see that there is a running pod here for minio. And it's up about 30 seconds. The last thing we want to check is that the persistent volume got created. So we would do kubectl get PV. And we can see here that there's a persistent volume created on the claim minio dev minio DirectPV PVC. The storage class is our DirectPV storage class. And this is 50 gigabytes. And it's read write once. And when we delete it, the reclaim policy is to actually delete that data. So be careful when you're deleting things if you've uploaded something important here and you have the reclaim policy set to delete, because it will actually delete your data. It'll just be gone. So be careful there. You can also have it basically wait for cleanup. There's another option there, but I would recommend diving into how persistent volume claims and storage classes work in Kubernetes. So it looks like we have all of our resources here. We can actually now take a look at the pod that is running and get more information about that pod specifically. So we can run this kubectl describe pod minio and namespace minio dev. And this gives you all of the information about that pod based on what is actually running in here. So you can get the name, the namespace, the IP address, what container was actually pulled, any mounts that are in here. So you can see that there are some data mounts in here for that, and some other information about where it was running and those kind of things. So you can see here that this is up and running now, and this should be good to go. We can also view the logs in here. This is a default Kubernetes concept as well. So we'll run our kubectl logs and specify the pod in the namespace where that pod is. We can actually see here that this is actually up and running with the default credentials. And note here that this is not going to be, so if you've installed this on your Linux system natively and you've gotten the IP address from this window, this is not going to be the publicly accessible IP address for this. This is the actual container or pod IP address running inside Kubernetes. So you're actually going to need another method to access this, which is what we will talk about next. So hopefully you've been able to customize that file to suit your environment, and you were able to actually get this up and running on your host. In the next section, we will talk about how to actually access this pod from outside of your cluster. So thanks for watching, and we will see you in the next video. Have a good one.